Haatchi and Little Bee by Wendy Holden. Read by Gabrielle Glaister. Author's note. Once in a while in life, if we're lucky, we come across those who leave footprints, or paw prints, on our hearts, and we are never quite the same again. Haatchi and Little Bee touched me that way from the moment I was first alerted to their story in late 2012. There was something about the expressions on both their faces that tugged at my heart and demanded my attention. A lifelong animal lover and a champion of the underdog, I was intensely moved when I read more about their extraordinary experiences and how fate had brought them together. That would make a great book, I told myself. A few months later, I was unexpectedly asked if I would consider writing that book by Haatchi's adoptive mother, Colleen, and her future husband, Will, the father of Little Bee. A difficult project I'd been working on for months had fallen through, and I was not only available but in need of fresh inspiration. Fate, which had already played such a hand in the experiences of one dog and his boy, drew me to one of the most life-enhancing families I could ever hope to meet. This is so much more than just a story of unspeakable cruelty to a defenceless animal. It is the redemptive tale of what happens to the spirit in the face of unconditional love, trust, and forgiveness. It shows how the worst of human nature can bring out the best. A remarkable little boy and his family rescued a three-legged dog, who then paid them back a thousandfold, changing all their lives forever. Their story is far from over, and it will continue to inspire and change the lives of everyone who is lucky enough to meet them in the years to come. I know, because it changed mine. And my heart is covered in their prints. Wendy Holden. Adapt yourself to the things among which your lot has been cast, and love sincerely the fellow creatures with whom destiny has ordained that you shall live. Marcus Aurelius. Prologue. Lifting his head, he sniffed the chill night air with his wet black nose. He tried to move, but the pain was too severe, so he slumped back down where he lay between the railway tracks. Peering right and left through amber eyes, he wondered where his human had gone and why he'd been abandoned there in the dark. Had he done something wrong? Would someone come to help him? He sensed the train long before he heard it. The metal tracks began to vibrate almost imperceptibly at first. The vibrations increased until they pulsed like an electric current through his body, making him quiver from top to tail. Wriggling, he tried once more to raise himself, but still he couldn't move. The more he struggled, the more the pain shot through his lower body. Cocking his head to one side, his finely tuned hearing picked up the rumbling of the approaching train as the tracks shivered and shook beneath him. Then the spotlights of the freight locomotive were looming towards him like the oncoming headlights of a car. An unstoppable machine. Its destination was the massive goods and marshalling yard adjacent to New Spitalfields Fruit and Vegetable Market in East London. Still straining and trying to use his size and strength to overcome the pain that pinned him in the path of the monster, the big dog billowed clouds of steamy breath. But no matter how much he wrestled, he couldn't escape. Whimpering, he turned his head quizzically to look up at the driver illuminated high in his cab, completely oblivious to what was about to happen as his chain of 30-ton wagon sped closer and closer to where the creature lay. The driver couldn't say later what it was that made him glance down onto the tracks at the last minute. Maybe it was the look in the dog's eyes, or could it have been a final desperate bark? Either way, there was nothing he could do but let out a small cry as he felt the train give a slight jolt before rattling on into the night. Chapter 1. All the darkness in the world cannot extinguish the light of a single candle. St. Francis of Assisi. Nobody can be certain how the dog who was later designated Stray E10 came to be on the railway tracks that bitter night of 9th of January 2012. Few could fathom what kind of human being would abandon a five-month-old Anatolian shepherd in a securely fenced-off area on a busy railway line with no means of escape. Those who found him thought he may have been clubbed around the head and face with a blunt instrument and thrown onto the line. Some reports claimed that he may have been tied to the tracks and speculated that the wheels of the train severed his bonds, allowing him to escape further injury. Only one person knows the full story. The man with a foreign accent who was responsible for the defenceless animal that night. He was spotted briefly on the tracks by a railway operations manager minutes before the dog was found. But he scurried off into the darkness before any searching questions could be asked. Not surprisingly, he never came forward to claim the animal he'd left behind. No matter what the precise circumstances of the events that led to the near-fatal mutilation of the handsome young dog, everyone agrees that it was an act of barbaric cruelty. It could have been the work of a madman, or the result of a deal gone wrong. Perhaps the long-legged hound was no longer cute enough to make his breeder the £500 plus that Anatolian shepherds frequently fetched. He might have been as large as a Labrador, but he was still only a puppy, and puppies can be both demanding and expensive. Nor does anyone know exactly what happened next. The driver who first reported hitting an animal on the line wasn't even initially sure it was a dog, and he certainly didn't believe the creature could have survived the impact. Part of him must have hoped that its death had been quick and painless. The first miracle, though, is that the dog wasn't killed outright. Somehow, as the goods train bore down upon him, he managed to flatten himself against the track bed and avoid fatal injuries. Sadly, he was unable to escape the train altogether, and the wheels almost severed his back left leg. The second miracle is that, driven by an innate instinct to escape from danger, he somehow managed to lift his shattered body onto his uninjured legs and limp away, leaving a telltale trail of blood. There can be no disputing that he would have been in acute pain as he pulled himself across to what he must have hoped was a place of safety, where he slumped between adjacent tracks. Little did he know that in that busy rail corridor, with only narrow shingle banks on either side, he was still directly in the line of freight and passenger traffic. No one can know how long after the first impact the abandoned Anatolian shepherd lay there in the cold, without food or water, losing blood, sniffing at and occasionally licking his wounds. Further train drivers who spotted him near what is known locally as the Ruckholt Road Junction, on the edge of Hackney Marsh and Leighton, alerted staff working in the operations control room. Someone there then contacted the network's mobile operations manager, Nigel Morris, and asked him to investigate. But it was decided not to shut down the vital rail lifeline until there had been a direct sighting of the injured animal and confirmation that it was still alive. Carrying a torch and letting himself into the secure area via a locked metal gate, Nigel began searching for a dog on the line. The area where it had been sighted was extremely busy that night, with a total of four lines carrying passenger trains to London Stansted Airport and Cambridge, as well as freight trains to and from the goods yard. Nigel was initially directed to the Temple Mills area, where barking had been heard, but it turned out to be a guard dog patrolling a locked trading estate. He started making his way back down the track in the other direction, when suddenly he came across a man walking along the line towards him in the dark. The heavy-set stranger had two huge dogs with him, an Alsatian and a Mastiff, both on short leashes. Nigel couldn't understand how the interloper had managed to get through multiple fences and tight security with two big dogs. He had a far more pressing concern, however. Trains were still passing them, so he quickly used his radio to report a trespasser on the line and call for the trains to be stopped. As Nigel drew closer to the stranger, he called out and asked him what he was doing there. The man, who was in his 40s and around 6 feet tall with what sounded like an Eastern European accent, seemed completely unfazed. He claimed that he was looking for his dog. Strangely, though, he was walking away from where Nigel had been told an injured dog had been seen. As Nigel's chief concern was to get the man off the track and to safety, he let him and his dogs out through the nearest access gate and quickly radioed that the trains could start running again. He called after the stranger to tell him that he'd keep looking for his dog, but was surprised when the man showed no interest and scurried off. Nigel watched him slope away into the darkness, then carried on searching along the track with his torch until eventually he spotted what he later described as a shadow between the rails. It was a dog, just lying there flat on its chest without moving. Nigel approached cautiously, although he assumed that it was dead and that he would have to deal with the body. When he got closer, however, he saw to his surprise that the animal was still alive, though its left rear leg and paw were covered in blood. Nigel quickly realised that the dog was not only docile, but too severely injured to attack him. He tried to shift it off the rails, but ended up with blood all over his clothes and shoes. It was clear he wouldn't be able to manage on his own. He called his control room and asked them to contact the RSPCA and get them to send one of their officers to help him. Then he stayed near the injured dog and waited. The RSPCA's uniformed welfare officer on duty in East London that winter's night was Siobhan Trinneman, so it was she who received the call just after 7 p.m. to attend a dog on the line. Having taken a note of the postcode, somewhere in E10, she jumped into her Citroën Berlingo van with the distinctive RSPCA logo on the side and drove to the area, which lay in the shadow of the massive new Olympic site. Nigel Morris met her on the street and unlocked an access gate, which allowed them to pass through the secure fencing erected as part of the Olympics' Ring of Steel. Siobhan eventually found herself standing on the perilously narrow shingle strip at the edge of the busy line that transported people and produce across the country and beyond. As trains continued to trundle past, she picked her way over the uneven, pebbly ground to where Nigel had discovered the dog. Shining the beam of her torch left and right, she eventually found the animal lying between the tracks. She could see immediately that it was in a bad way and bleeding heavily. Standing a safe distance from where it lay, Siobhan played her torchlight along its body and noted that it was a male dog with serious injuries to its lower limbs. She was relieved to see him lift his head and look straight at her. Then she heard something that made her gasp. Jumping back against a fence, she realised that another train was approaching. Nigel quickly reassured her. "It's okay," he said. "Watch. The dog knows what to do. The train's just ride over it. There's just enough room as long as it doesn't try to get up." The two of them pressed back and held their breath as a passenger train rattled towards the dog at a speed of around 45 miles per hour. Siobhan watched in amazement as the animal, ears flattened to his head, simply lay back down and let the train rumble over him. As soon as the final carriage had passed, he lifted his head again, ears pricked, and looked across at them to reassure himself that they were still there. The minute she saw the pleading look in his eyes, Siobhan begged Nigel to get the line shut down as quickly as possible. With so many urban foxes, stray dogs and cats crisscrossing Britain's busy train tracks every day, it is Network Rail's policy not to shut down a line for an animal, and no longer even to caution train drivers. They can, however, order a signaller to carry out what is known as a line blockage if people or animals are considered to be in direct danger. Nigel radioed his control room and had the line temporarily closed for the second time that night so that he and Siobhan could cross safely to where the injured dog lay. As soon as they were promised that all trains had been stopped in both directions further up the tracks, they hurried to his side. The first thing Siobhan noticed was that the top of the dog's head was noticeably swollen. In her 5 years as an RSPCA officer, she had seen countless victims of abuse and cruelty, and experience told her he'd been hit on the head by something, most likely a blunt instrument. A train would have done far more damage. His leg and tail were badly mangled, and his tail especially was losing blood. She couldn't tell if he had any internal injuries, but he didn't appear to be too tender inside when she examined him, and she knew a trained vet would be able to establish exactly what was wrong. In spite of his injuries, the dog seemed sweet-natured, and not at all like so many she had to deal with in her line of duty. A lot of animals as badly hurt as he was would have growled if she even came close, and would almost certainly have tried to bite her. She carried a muzzle just in case. This gentle giant didn't seem to mind her touching him at all, though, and only whimpered a little when she did so. Siobhan had the authority to order that an animal in distress or seriously injured could be put to sleep at the scene by a vet if she thought it was beyond help. However, because this dog didn't appear to be injured anywhere else and was, as she later said, so lovely and friendly, she made the decision there and then to try to save him. With some difficulty, she and Nigel took one end of the dog each and managed to get him up onto three legs before carrying him a couple of hundred yards to where she'd parked her van. Apart from the odd whimper, he barely made a sound as they moved him and then lifted him into the back. As she wasn't qualified as a vet, Siobhan carried no pain relief, but she settled him onto bedding on his uninjured side and thanked the operations manager for his help.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.